The first day of this school is dedicated to signal processing. So we will show you how to analyze signals, how to process and how to synthesize. And these are very important models, because when you go towards more statistical approaches, more you need a vocoder, at least at the moment. And the quality that you can have from a statistical model depends a lot on the vocoder. Recently, there are advancements on Sinusoidal modeling, and Sinusoidal model has been around for speech since 1984, and in a conference 1983 from Macaulay and Quartieri. This is a very important work and got actually the IEEE's best paper award in 1985. That sounds really, probably you were, some people here, probably they were not born yet, but that was an important model that we used a lot in speech. And we will show you first the basics on Sinusoidal model. Why? Because the next technical lecture is on the advanced Sinusoidal model. So it's very important to, in order to understand the advanced Sinusoidal model, to understand and make sure that we have a common understanding of Sinusoidal model. I like to excuse myself for people that they are expert in Sinusoidal modeling. Probably they will not be so much interested in the first part, but I must say I will use first a notation, so to introduce you to the notation, so that this, even if you are expert in the Sinusoidal model, is good to watch this. Second, always the views from where we see a Sinusoidal model is important. If it is, for instance, for speech coding, it's different from speech synthesis. And the Sinusoidal model originally has been suggested for speech coding. So, so we will first see the Sinusoidal model, the basics, how that is connected to the speech production mechanism. And also, I like to excuse myself to people who are not signal processing oriented, because this is a bit heavy in mathematics. But I will try to explain as much as I can. Now, when we go to advanced Sinusoidal model, then we see a bit more opportunities on how to use it for speech synthesis. And then Yannis Ayomirianakis from Google will show you how to combine this into really a vocoder that is currently in use from Google. And he will teach us this afternoon, but also later on how to do voice morphing. And so that's why we start from Sinusoidal models. And again, Ranieri Maya from Toshiba has a different view of vocoding. He is using complex Kepstra, both for minimum phase and maximum phase, or from minimum phase and all pass information of speech. But unfortunately, he's not here with us. So we will study a lot Sinusoidal model. And hopefully when Ranieri reaches us, then we can see if he can talk about complex Kepstra in one of the sessions later on. Okay? Okay, so that is the introduction and why we pick up Sinusoidal model. So I will talk about speech production, first of all, just to see the principles and the modulators and see how these, in that context, Sinusoidal model fits. Because Sinusoidal model, you can see it very simply as a Fourier transform. So why to bother with speech production and modulators? But actually, if you want to do something useful for speech synthesis, voice conversion, etc., with SynSIG model, it is very important to see the connection between SynSIG model and the speech production mechanism. Then we will go and we will see a specific another category of SynSIG models, the harmonic models. And there we will talk about the harmonic plus noise model. That is a model that I developed when I was doing my PhD, like when I was around your age. And there we suggested three harmonic plus noise models. So I will quickly look at these models, try to explain you from where they come from and why we suggested at that time. And especially one of them, we will make a focus, because that will be the continuation of the next technical lecture, which is going to be the quasi-harmonic model and adaptive harmonic model. Okay, so here is the simple view. That is from the book, excellent book for speech processing, Quartieri, from MIT Lincoln Labs. So, excellent book. So, if you really look for a book, that's a very good book. That is number one reference here, and you will see it later on. So, we start here. I don't know if... Okay, nice. You can see this. So, we start with the power supply. That means here, our lungs. And... the air passes through this modulator, which are the vocal folds. And then through pharynx, the glottal airflow goes towards the oral cavity and the nasal cavity. Now, at that level, there are some productions, like periodic puffs, as it is shown here. This is for voice speech and noise. This is for the unvoiced speech. The first is for ah, oh, eh, this kind periodic signals, and noise like sh, f, these kind of things. Now, this impulse is not really generated, the impulses like t, k, they are not generated here, they are generated in the vocal tract, which is this one. Anyway, all of these, although this is shown as modulator, all these are modulators, and we have a major modulator here, and this is very important for the quality of speech, and this is a modulator in order to recognize speech, to make recognizable sounds. At this level, this modulator, as I said, it is associated to the quality of speech. So when we do speech synthesis, the first thing that we ask is quality. That's why this part is very important to address. The problem is that we don't have access to these modulators. We have access to the signal that we get here as measure of a change of the pressure. That is what a microphone collects. And then this signal, of course, is traveling, arrives to this lady's ear here. Then there is another mechanism. We will not talk about that because... we will talk a bit because we will talk about speech intelligibility. And that comes from a mechanism of our auditory system. Here there is the outer, middle, and inner ear. The inner ear is the cochlea. And then this signal is analyzing in frequencies. And this is the place theory of Bekesi. And on Friday, when I will talk about the 25th anniversary of Cambridge Research Lab of Toshiba, I will show you some very interesting pictures of the inner ear, the decomposition of sounds to frequencies, and that is the 1961 Bekesi theory, place theory, and he got a Nobel for that. Nevertheless, that goes then to acoustic nerve, which sends the signal stimulations to the brain, and somewhere there, in some areas that more or less we know the representation of the sound is located. That the patterns that we create inside the brain then drive us our modulators. And through the speech that we produce, the sounds that we produce, we have a feedback mechanism through our ear to, because we have a pattern for our, let's say, mother or father's speech, and it is saved here. So we try to mimic this. We move our articulators, and we see that the sounds is not exactly the same, and then we correct that. And this is the way that we learn the first 3 to 5 to 3 years, let's say, to speak. And then the next one level, of course, is the greatest invention that humans made, the language. And that is through speech. Then that's a very high level of information. And language, of course, it is associated with a lot of things in our current, in everyday life. Like this person says to this woman, go and shop, do shopping. So you see here now, shh, there is this unvoiced sounds. This is the O, the voiced, which comes from this one. And this is the impulsive sound, like p, which is created at the level of lips. The vocal airflow stops there, and then there is the release and P. So that's why we see now we recognize the three sources, noisy, periodic, and impulsive. Now, the first thing, as I said, comes from the vocal folds. Again, on Friday, I will show you vocal folds vibration. Right now, it's just a schematic. The left is this one. The right is this one. This is when there is voicing. The vocal folds, really, there is tension, and the air passes, but there is also oscillation. While for breathing, the vocal folds are quite relaxed, and that is very important because we want, in very short time, to get as much air as we want. As we need, so that this should not be an obstacle anymore, should be relaxed. But when there is voicing, it is important to control these vocal folds to create either relaxed or less relaxed or tension of vocal folds in order to produce the different sources that we have seen. So that means I have different tension. For instance, if I produce a sustained vowel or sh, that's different different position of my vocal folds. That means I control this through the brain, and I control it because I have heard these sounds, I have the pattern, and then I control. At some point, I might lose that control. For instance, I could be like as I'm getting older, then probably I will start losing the capability of controlling the vocal folds. And that is the first sign that something goes wrong in my brain, because I cannot control this that I learned. It's not like this is not an animal anymore process. This is human process. And so when I start having problems, then first I cannot process very well memory, etc., then I will probably start losing also the capability to control, finally control my vocal folds. The same thing happens if, for instance, I can control, but my vocal folds have problems. And that is, for instance, for speech pathology. Yes, please.
Briefly, will these slides be available online?
Yes. So you don't need to get even the videos. Yeah? So these are very important functions. And that's why also, and our lab has a lot of experience on quality of voice, how to control the quality of voice, either to check the if there is any pathology or in terms of vocal fold vibration, that means if there is like and I forgot even the terms, polyps here, or there is a damage in the brain. But we're not going to look at that in this summer school. So when there is the vibration, first of all, sometimes people call that vocal cords, but we discover that these are not really cords, these are folds. That means there is mass, and they move this way. And we will see, definitely I have one video that shows vibration of sustained phonation, but this is probably something that we can find easily in the internet, and this is with aliasing frequencies. The thing is that we use videos with 20 frames per second, but my vocal folds right now, when I say ah, vibrate with 120 times per second. So how I can see that? The answer is you have to use high-speed camera. And then when you record that, you have to wait to see the movements with 25 frames per second, but without the aliasing frequencies. If you want to see and vibration, you will see aliasing frequencies. That means you will see the vibration, but mainly you don't see the vibrations. You see some of the activity. Nevertheless, when there is the vibration, then we recognize two major phases. This is the closed phase, for example, where the vocal folds are closed and there is no air that is passing through. This is here, the closed phase. There is the open phase, which is this one. So gradually now the glottal airflow velocity is increasing. So closed phase, there's no really velocity, no air goes through. Then there is this, which is the open phase. And then there is the return phase. The return phase, that means we go back to the closed phase. And then we continue. And this is the periodic thing that we observe when we say, for instance, ah. When we say shh, there is no such a periodic thing. Now, why there is this return phase? Everything has to do with the pressure. For instance, why here the vocal folds open? And why here they go to the return phase? This is always controlled by the air pressure. And there are two air pressures, below the glottal, the glottis, and above the glottis. So when the air pressure under the glottis is smaller than the air pressure above the glottis, we are in the closed phase. When the below the glottis, the pressure is higher than above the glottis, then the glottis starts to open, and then the air passes through. But as we do that, then there is now a process that the pressure between above the glottis and under the glottis is equal. And then we start the return phase because, look, this is opened, but it has a mass, cannot stay there, so we'll go down. And depend on the how big are your vocal folds, we'll do that quickly or less frequent. For instance, and this is one difference between males and females. Males, for instance, have big mass of vocal folds, bigger than females. So then there is the notion of inertia and how the vocal folds then vibrate. That's why the males have lower pitch, lower fundamental frequency than the male speaker, than the female speakers. And the same thing we can think for kids, for instance, which have even less mass than the female voices, female speakers, sorry. Now, another thing that we have to observe here is that this is, again, not really the vocal flow velocity, it's just a schematic representation of that. And there are two problems with that. First, that the vocal air flow, it does not go that easily from here to here. There are some differences. And the differences are like here, there is some oscillations. It's not like a straight line or kind of hyperbolic here line. It is, there are oscillations. These oscillations are related to the glottal formant, as we say, because this is a filter, the first filter. A modulator means filter. That means is the first formant. That it is a system that means has an eigenfrequency, and that eigenfrequency is the glottal formant, and it is obviously related to the particular vocal folds that I, Yannis, has. I have this. You have different vocal folds. So that is also a clue that in 1995, something, people used to extend the features for speaker identification using also source. And I will come to that again when we will say about the 25th anniversary of Toshiba. I will say too many things about the 25th anniversary. Anyway, that is one thing. The other thing is that when the vocal folds open, then the air does not go just straight away traveling to our vocal tract. There are also a lot of noise around the vocal folds. And that means that some sounds, they are not really very periodic. They are not, there is with strictly periodic pulses, but there is also the noise that it is produced towards at the edges of the vocal folds. This is very well known in sound waves, when sound is produced. And the last thing is that we say this is a periodic signal, so what happened here will be repeated. But there is no such a thing in nature, and I can claim also, even in machines, that can make this thing to be periodic in a strictly mathematical sense. First of all, you understand that this cannot be the same as this. So first, this is not periodic in a strictly sense. But you can say, we are engineers, not mathematicians. We will say, yeah, it's about the same. Okay, I agree. But you have another problem. The distance from here to here, not only just the shape, but the distance from here to here, whoops, from here to here, you say it is the same from here to here. This is not true in speech. And this, I can again claim that there is no machine that can do even that. So there is no periodic sound. So why do we bother about periodic sounds? This is the same thing why we bother about complex numbers, because it helps us to develop systems, and then we can use them as engineers. Okay? So these are the observations about this little modulator that you have to pay attention, otherwise you will have problems, like I will have problems at the end of this talk if I don't drink water during my speech. So protect it. This is very important. Okay, now we moved from that modulator, we go to the vocal tract. There we have a very important articulator. One of them is the tongue. Indeed, it's very important because can move. And probably you have seen videos. I will show again a video on Friday while we talk how the articulators are moving. It's amazing, amazing how they are moving, how much we can control them. And as I said, tongue is one, can position from back, forth, and then we can say back vowels or front vowels. We can touch the palate like here, and then this is the way to produce plosives. But also it can be high but not touching the palate, and that is when the fricative sounds are produced. And of course we have the lips. There's, for instance, these are the major ones, but the teeth, if something is missing here, then I will be there. I cannot produce any more the shh sounds very well. And now this is the high level, let's say, description of the speech production mechanism. But in order to study the speech production mechanism, you have to use now mathematics. And you have to use signal processing theory. And here is an important operation, that of convolution. So let's assume that the vocal tract is a filter and has an impulse response h of n. So the excitation, that the signal that goes towards that, can be also an a result of a convolution between this glottal signal, that is the signal that is like that, the opening and the closing, convolved by a series of pulses. That's the P of N, which are periodic. These are Kronecker pulses spaced by P, where P, let's say, is the period. Then convolve this signal, the closing, opening, and return, just that, which is the glottal signal, with the series of pulses, then will create this series of glottal airflow velocities pictures that we have seen, and this is then the U of N. The U of N is exactly, let's say, looks like this one. Then this excites the H of N, which is the impulse response of the vocal tract. So the result of this, which is U of N, travels, and we obviously here we use the hypothesis that H of N is a linear and time-invariant filter in order to write the... Otherwise, we are not allowed to write convolutions here in that such a simple way. And then that goes and is producing, let's say, the speech out of the lips, outside the lips. And then we observe this through windows in order to make the assumption that the signal that we are observing is stationary. Why? Because the mathematical tools that we use make the assumption of stationarity. But we will see that this is not true. And more you go towards advanced modeling of speech, you have to take this into account. And then that's the windowed speech around time tau or tau, as we say in Greek. Then, of course, you can apply a Fourier transform of it. And then people who are familiar with signal processing, then you know that convolution in time means multiplication in frequency domain. And then these convolutions become multiplications. But, and this is the Fourier transform of H of N, this is the Fourier transform of G of N, this is the, as we say, the glottis signal. And this P of N, which is periodic, we know from the Fourier transform that it's also a periodic pulses. Yeah, please.
So is H the excitation of the vocal tract?
It's U of N, the excitation of the vocal tract.
And then what is H?
H is the impulse response of the vocal tract. Okay, so, yes, please.
Are you dismissing the lip radiation from this analysis?
Is it included?
Are you using the lip radiation effect?
Yes, H of N is considered also all the vocal tract. And now, when we do the Fourier transform, we know that P of N also it is 1 over P, and then there are pulses all again, but not repeated every P, which is the period, but over 1 over P. That is, makes to the frequencies, which are the omega k. And then we have here the convolution outside, which when you write the equations, necessary to say the details here, but easily you can then put this W inside and the sum, and then it is mainly a modulated window, which is the Fourier transform of the window sitting on multiples of fundamental frequency, if we say periodic signals, as we started to say, or at the frequencies omega k. And this is then the Fourier transform of that speech signal around time tau. Okay, so how does it look now? This, if we take the magnitude spectrum of H omega G omega, this one, then this is the line. This is called spectral envelope, the bold line here. But actually, we do not observe this. What we observe, based on this equation, is a sampled version of that envelope, which is defined, the sampling, by this omega k, these frequencies. And in short, we observe this. What is this? What is each one of them? This is the Fourier transform, just the main lobe of the window. And it is modulated, as I mentioned here, is sitting at different frequencies, omega k. So around omega 1, omega 2, omega whatever. So this is really what we observe. And we know that underlying process has a filter. If we put together now the vocal tract and the glottis filter together, like this one, that they have a spectral envelope. But we do not observe the spectral envelope. We observe only these peaks. So how to go from these peaks to the envelope is one very important research problem. And actually, it is related, it is at the heart of coding, vocoding for speech synthesis. And this is from where really Strait comes from, like a very important vocoder that we all use for speech synthesis. This is the spectral envelope estimation is the key, is one of the keys, actually. And this is, you will see more about that from Yannis later on, who will say, how do we use that information? But very important for speech production is some frequencies which are maxima here, the frequencies where we have the maxima of that underlying not observed envelope. And these are, in mathematics, called eigenfrequencies. In engineering, speech processing are called formants. And these are the maxima here. To find the maxima, it's also very important, because it is through them that we recognize speech and we do automatic speech recognition, either explicitly or implicitly. Now, you can see that when, for instance, this lobe here is not here, but it is located where the formant is, then we are lucky because we can find the first formant or the second formant. But normally, this doesn't happen very often. However, people who are trained to sing in the opera, they know this mechanism and they change their vocal tract accordingly so that the formant and this one, omega 1, let's say that the fundamental frequency, they go together, one on top of the other. Why? Because here you don't have so much energy. Here you have energy. So you don't want to change the sound. If you sang, you can modify the beat, but the purpose is to reach the omega 1, which is the tone that the orchestra is playing. And obviously, this is very important information. So you have to move your formant without changing the identification of the vowel that you sing on the pitch that the orchestra is playing. And this is learned during many courses when you learn how to sing the opera. Okay, so after that, we arrive to more specific models now on this, because that was the general production mechanism. Now we arrive to the sinusoidal models. What is a sinusoid? Yeah, sinusoid, let me see. This one. What is a sinusoid? It's an oscillator, so that is the maximum displacement, A, then the distance from here to here is, as we said, a period, and the fundamental frequency of that is 1 over p. And then there is this delay here from the observation time t equals 0 is called the phase displacement. And that makes the signal of A, let's say cosine, since I used F0 to be F0t plus that displacement phi. So that is phi is very important also in speech synthesis because it is associated to the excitation phase somehow. And that is important because it is the excitation phase for the quality of speech that you generate. And then that is, let's say, an oscillator. Now, imagine we can put this as omega zero. And I think I have more space. Imagine now if for that you have some of them. This is a powerful model because can model a lot of sounds, including speech, music, etc. So we go from that simple oscillator to a combined oscillator, and this is the Sinusoidal model. But because we have only cosines, and cosines are the functions, let's say, which are even, that means we can very well produce, let's say, simple in this simple way, only even functions, even sounds. But the sound has also odd parts and even parts. Any signal can be written as the sum of even and odd parts. Then we have to write sum here with a function of, let's say, bk sinus. Another phase here. Okay, so, and if we use Euler formula, instead of cosine and sine, we can use the complex numbers, and then we go to exponentials. And that is what we have here, where we have 2 pi fk, that is the omega k, j, exponential, time, the signal, and we have k components. The gamma k are the complex amplitudes, however. Now, this is in a polar format. And these are, gamma k are complex numbers. They have the amplitude information and the phase displacement. Now, a specific case of the Sinusoidal model is if I have, I put a constraint on fk to make it k times f0. Then that means I don't have too many frequencies to bother with, but just one, the F0. And then I make the assumption that all the frequencies Fk are multiples of that F0. Then, once we have that, we have to estimate the parameters from speech. And usually we use, it is called a linear approach. These, if we know this Fk, because, okay, we have, what are, which are the unknowns? Let's say the X of t is the known. The unknowns are the gamma k and the fk. These are unknowns. This system, however, is nonlinear. You cannot solve it in a linear way. It's a nonlinear. However, if you know fk, or if you know the f0, so you know the fk through this assumption of k times f0, then the system becomes linear, and you can solve it very easily. What does that mean? It means that when I know fk, then I can make, as we say, a space generated by these functions, the exponentials. And then this operation here, when multiply that space by s, is projecting s, which is the speech sound, the sound that we have generated, we have measured through the microphones and the analog to digital conversion. We have the samples here. We project them on that space, and the output that we get are this gamma k, which are the complex amplitudes. So this is the linear algebra way to show how to estimate the parameters. But there is also another engineering part, which arrive to the same equations. Nevertheless, it is called mean square error estimation. That means these are the measurements. This is X. I said before it's speech, but actually it is our model. Then we try to minimize the distance between the model and the observations. And this is called mean squared error, for obvious reasons. So now we have to take derivative of epsilon over the unknown parameters. But if we know fk, then the system becomes linear, and the solution is through the linear algebra system that I show here. Okay. One point is, if you see this, this is simply the Fourier transform. So you can apply it, for instance, on the sounds from ducks. You can apply it on the sounds that cars generate, noise, or the noise from these ventilators. But once you go to speech, of course, you can apply just do Fourier transform, get amplitudes, frequencies. Somehow you can do something. I will show you how. And that's it. But if you don't see behind the scenes what is happening and you don't take into account the speech production mechanism, you don't have chance to enhance this model and apply it effectively, efficiently in the speech synthesis problem. So we go back now and we say, okay, let's make a step and see, step back, and say, can we see the sinusoidal model in the context of source? That means the glottal airflow velocity and filter. Then, traditionally, in speech coding, we had this series of pulses, and we say if it is voice, we have series of pulses. If it is noise, we have just noise components, and then we can mix them. And we made the linear prediction coding. We made even coded excited linear prediction and blah, blah, etc. Here, we say the excitation, the source signal, the U of T, is a sum of sinusoids. Because we know with this sum of sinusoids, we can produce any sound from noise to purely periodic signals. Okay? So I can then have a general representation of the excitation. A specific, so this is the amplitude information. So this is an AM-FM signal. This is modeled using amplitude modulation and frequency modulation components. The frequency modulation components actually comes from the phase, and the phase is defined as the integral of the instantaneous frequency plus this displacement that I said previously, the phase displacement. So now, this is a time-varying function, and you can also simplify it by make the assumption that this is k times omega zeros, that means constant over time as a function. And then this integral is not anymore integral. It's very simple. I mean, it's very just a straight line if it is a constant. Now, if you make this as a function that moves over time with, let's say, a linear way, then this integral will make the phase a quadratic function, etc. You add one component. And the impulse response of the vocal tract, including lips, as people said before, they are also magnitude information and frequency information. And this is through the phase, and this is the amplitude again. It is an AM-FM, again, representation. Now, we will pass this U of T through this. If the U of T is not a sum, it's just this one, AK exponential, each exponential we know through the linear system theory that will generate is an eigenfunction, which means that the output, when this passes through this filter, will be exactly the same one, but its amplitude will be modified by a constant. And that is the eigenvalue That means that this system has eigenfrequencies. If, because this is, again, has an informational frequency. If that frequency, however, the eigenfrequency, is not an eigenfrequency, which means the system has not that frequency, the output will be zero. Now, we can extend this. When we have a sum, then it's not any more eigenfrequency, but because the system is linear and time invariant, we can say that the output is a sum of eigenfunctions. And that is the speech, which is shown here. And now, what is this then amplitude? It is the multiplication of the amplitude that comes from the vocal folds multiplied by the amplitude of the vocal tract. While the phase that we see here, because of the exponentials, if you multiply two exponentials, the magnitudes will be multiplied, as we show here, but the arguments will be added. So the phases are added now. The phase of the time-varying phase of the excitation signal and the phase of the vocal tract filter. So if we replace this phi k of t with the integral that we had before, this one plus the phase displacement, and then we just put there the phase from the vocal tract. So speech can be seen like that, as simple as a Fourier transform, but if you analyze these two components into excitation and source filter, you have to consider this information. Okay? Then you start making connections between the sinusoidal model, not just as a Fourier transform, but as a system that describes with high fidelity the speech production mechanism.
But to make it clear, it doesn't depend at all on these sample frequencies that you showed before.
Why?
I'm asking.
No, okay. So could you please repeat your question?
The big omega k there, does it depend on the little omega k's that were the frequencies being sampled before?
Yeah. It is. For instance, here we use omega k and omega k, and this is because when we do this, the eigenfrequency is the result. Mainly, when we pass this eigenfunction inside, mainly it means the output is a constant, which is the amplitude multiply of whatever we have as amplitude of that omega k, 1, and this amplitude here, which means the sample at frequency omega k. And at frequency omega k, so we have only one frequency comes in, the output is exactly the same function at that frequency, the eigenfrequency, and multiply by an eigenvalue, which is the multiplication of the two amplitudes, or alpha k and m. But the m is a function. The value of the function at omega k, at time t, this is the sample version that we see of that function, both for amplitude and for phase from the system. Okay? So that means while we speak, we produce different frequencies, and they sample the system at these specific frequencies, and this is a time varying. Here I have not put that tau, the Greek letter, but we can think that this omega k is a function also of time, because it changes while I'm talking. So I will go and say this slide, then we'll have a break, and then we will come back. Okay, so here now we make... I go slowly here because this is very important to understand these parts. Once you understand this, all the rest, you don't need me. You can understand it even without me talking. So the important part is now this stationarity. This is because, again, the basic tools that we use to analyze speech, like Fourier transform, make the assumption that signal is stationary. What does that mean in mathematics in this model? It is that around the instant that we observe, the amplitude, frequency, and even the number of components that we have, which is a function of time, inside that window that we are observing the sound, they are constant. They don't change. Obviously, since, for instance, what is the implications for that? When, for instance, the frequency we consider that does not change for, let's say, 25 milliseconds window analysis, then the phase, what is it? It is a linear function, a function of time, order one. This is because of the integral. And this is exactly what we show here. This, so the phase is function only of order one of the variable t. TL is the time where we do the analysis, the center, that tau that we mentioned. Okay, so if we, under this assumption, then S of t is become this inside this window. TL, as you can see here, is the center, and we take from that TL minus, we go back, T divided by 2, whatever is that T, is the half of the analysis window, and further T divided by 2. That means we have an analysis window around TL of T, capital T, samples, or say seconds. Now, if we do a discrete time analysis, not continuous, so now we did have samples, which are NW, then this phasor, as we call it, this is a phasor now. This is real, but this is the complex number. This is a phasor. This phasor is gamma k. And then this omega ktl, that is because of the discretization of time, becomes, in signal processing, then in discrete time, we use this, not the capital, but the lowercase omega to show that this is in discrete time. Then this is how we arrive to this model. And again, you can avoid to see all the rest, and you can think that of Fourier transform, that's it, speech. But you have to consider all the previous ones to understand that this is not just a Fourier transform. This can be applied to characterize with efficiently, as I mentioned before, the speech production mechanism. So it's up to you to decide to use just Fourier transform or to know what is this gamma k here and from where that came from. Of course, you don't have access to all this information. These are hidden. Okay, so the next one is going to be how do we go now to the mean squared error, how to estimate these parameters. But I suggest you take a break. Then we come back and we see now how do we get these features, okay? How to estimate these parameters of the model. And then we will continue, okay? The next one will be much faster, okay? Do you have any questions before you leave the room before the break? Okay, please, okay? Okay, so let's make like 5 minutes break and then come back. Okay, so now we can continue. Now, you'll notice here the change in the notation, and I apologize for that. So now the original waveform is not anymore S, but it is Y, while the model is not X, is S. So we like to minimize this mean squared error, which is this one. And this can be written in this way. Now, this is the Fourier transform of Y of N. Y of N is observed signal. And we do Fourier transform, and obviously we have some frequencies. This is a it is a Fourier transform, so we go from n to omega in general. And here we have the energy of the as what is called energy in signal processing for y of n observations. So we can show that this error can be written in this way. And you want to minimize this. Obviously, minimizing epsilon, you cannot do anything here. Yeah? The things that you can play with is this part. Especially, you cannot do anything also even here, because this is the Fourier transform of the speech at specific frequencies. But probably you can minimize this one. Then, if you minimize this one, then you can minimize epsilon. This is called maximum likelihood, actually, estimation. And it is maximum likelihood because you have a model. And you try to match that model to speech, to the observations. Yes, please.
The omega prime k's are, they're still free parameters.
Where? Well, these ones? Mm. Yes, because of the omega, indeed. So I will come back to that. But the first thing that we will observe as a way to minimize this is this one. Mm? So when this is minimum, obviously, when the difference here is zero. And when it is zero, when, for instance, these omega k are the same as the ones that we have from gamma. Imagine, again, remember, we know omega k because we try now to solve a linear system. So that means these are the peaks. These are, now we have to minimize this difference, and these are the phasors. So we can, since we know omega k, so we know where are located these, to make gamma k the values of the functions of y omega at the frequencies omega k. In short, let's say I have a function. I know that I want it here. These are the omega k. So then I can sample here, 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 but I know that my gamma k are located at omega 1, omega 2, etc. So the value, in order to make this 0, is to make gamma k equals to the values of gamma omega, this, and this, right? Then if we do that, this is zero. And then this is reduced to this. Now it comes what you just said. Now we want to minimize this. What is this minimization? This is the energy of the signal minus another energy. You probably remember from Parseval theorem that this is related also to an energy in time. This is Parseval. So, from where you're going to get the energy, you want to get from that energy, from which has many frequencies, some energy that comes from few frequencies. So, if we go back to this one, from where are you going to really to pick up? Is going to be this omega 1 or will be this one? Obviously, you will select the red one because this is a peak. You will not select probably this one, this one, this one. You will select probably this one. So now you have really an estimation of omega 1. Let's see, omega 2. Now I make it quite sparse. But nevertheless, that means, of course, I can remove all the frequencies. I can sample everywhere. And then this error is going to be zero. This is because of the Parseval theorem. But I don't want that. I want to minimize the error by picking up few frequencies that are related to the speech production. So I have to get a set of frequencies out of all these frequencies. So which are the frequencies that are, let's say, I do now a zoom out, and I have this. This is now y of omega. From where are the frequencies that I can pick up in order to reduce that error? Again, if I take all the frequencies, the error is zero. But this is, I know, I have not learned anything. But if now I do this, in short, the maxima of that y of omega, oops, then I can get an estimation of where this omega k should be. So now I have an estimation of omega k. And at that omega k, I can get just the values of the function at omega k. That minimizes then this error. And that is how we estimate the sinusoidal parameters and why this is a maximum likelihood approach. Now, we do that for this type of signals, but this type of signals are mostly the periodic signals, or quasi-periodic, I would say. What about, can you represent noise with sum of sinusoids? Because if you cannot do that, then you have to have a switch. Whenever it is voiced, you go to the sinusoidal model. Whenever it is noise, you go to something else. So this has been, of course, there are many speech models that they work like that, but this is not an efficient way to do things. So can we assume that sinusoidal model can both characterize periodic sounds and noisy sounds in the same way? So then you don't need this switch. And that's very important. And we say the answer is yes, you can. Actually, there is this Karhugen-Loew expansion, and that is the Fourier series, not for deterministic signals, the Fourier series expansion for stochastic signals. This is what is called, or otherwise, the KLT, Karhugen-Loew transformation. And that allows us to construct a random process using harmonic sinusoids with, as I said, uncorrelated complex amplitudes in order to have these random characteristics. However, in order to make this, there are some conditions. How close these frequencies that we will pick up will be? And how fast we sample this over time? And you can understand that very quickly because this is part of the sampling theorem, but in the frequency domain. If you have something like that, obviously, you need just one sample to represent this. But more you go to something like that, more samples you will need to represent nicely this process. And this can be sinusoids. Why can be sinusoids and not all the frequencies again? Because at the end, we have to represent, we have this speech production mechanism and theory, but remember, this is a system that has been suggested for speech coding. For speech coding, you don't have infinite number of parameters. You have few parameters. Then you try to quantize them. So you cannot have infinite number of frequencies because you are going to have infinite complex amplitudes then. So you, the thing is how to use the minimal information that you need to represent the process. The bottom line is, because of Karhugen-Loev, you can represent now both periodic and non-periodic parts as a sum of sinusoids. That's the key. So you don't need any more switch. And this shows peak picking for a voiced, because we call this peak picking. And this is an unvoiced. So this is like the Karhugen-Loev, and this is the deterministic representation. In short, sum of sinusoids for everything. And we found that approximately for, let's say, 4 kilohertz bandwidth, 80 parameters are enough to represent the speech, both voiced and unvoiced, without... When we reconstruct the signal, you cannot make really difference between the original one and the reconstructed one. But we will talk more about that, and you have a hands-on version, session in the afternoon, and you will play with this type of signals, and you will hear also, you will make reconstructions, and then you can see the difference between the reconstructed and the original signal. And then you can play with the parameters, etc., number of parameters. So we call that this peak picking. Okay, so now we have the amplitudes, complex amplitudes, we have the frequencies, so we can... We have this. So now we can put it in the formula. We can have S of n. Since we have S of n, let's say this one, we can move half, let's say this is the offset, the shift that we do in the analysis. And then we generate another one from the next frame. So these are called frames. Then the next one, another frame. And then we can put them together to do the overlap and add process called OLA. And then if we do this overlap and add, we add these frames and we generate the speech. And this is the reconstructed. It says here synthesized, but because we do text to speech and we say synthesis of speech, this is not text to speech. This is reconstructed signal, okay? This is one way to do it, simple way. But there is another way, which is to match. So now you have at this time instant, like L, and another time instant, L plus one, you have now components estimated. And let's say you have picked up at omega one, omega two, omega three, etc. And the next frame, you have also, let's say, three components, just three components. Then, but obviously, since my frequency content changes as I speak, the frequencies also, the peak picking mechanism picks different frequencies. If, let's say, we have three and three, then we have to do like a frequency matching to observe how my frequency changes over time. Of course, I don't have any information between the instance of my centers of the analysis window. I have only here and here. So a simple assumption can be like a linear interpolation, linearly change from this to this. Okay, that works well. But what about if here we picked up three and the next one we have five? Then that means... Something, how we're going to do the association, what is called frequency matching. Probably this goes here, and this, somehow it is there, but did not exist in the past. Or if still we have three and three, but this is such a fast change, and it happens while I speak, like in emotional speech, things change very fast. How are you going to do the association? Are you going to do this to this, so to nothing, or this to this? So these are to be or not to be kind of questions. So to analyze more of this than what Shakespeare did, we go further and we say, okay, so at this time and next time, so this is the LF frame, this is the L plus one, this can be associated to a certain frequency, like this one, and has search bin plus delta minus delta, where you search to see if really you have some frequencies picked up by the peak-picking mechanism inside this interval. Let's say that inside this interval you have two peaks picked. The one which is closest to the previous one, it is associated. This one has two options, either to die, or either to be born. And this, actually, because it appears here, we say this is born. This is the birthday of this frequency. So this is a dynamic programming problem, obviously. And here we see how it evolves over time. And then there is this. This is not associated to anyone, so must die. This is here, a new information, before was not here, so must be born. So then we have the death and birth process. And then this is how it looks over time, the association from one frame to the other frame. And this is, of course, just an example, but this is from a real speech, how it looks. And then you can understand, okay, wow, here we have peaks in the high frequencies. Not so much information here. So from where this comes from? The answer is here, from unvoiced segment. Why? Because sounds like shh. They have more energy, so more peaks in the high frequencies. And since I have put a constraint on the number of components I can pick up, then obviously the maximum energy comes from the high frequencies for the unvoiced sounds. For the voice segment, I have almost equally distributed energy and in nicely not random space, which is related to F0. F0, 2 times F0, etc. So that means fundamental harmonics after that. And here you don't see any structure, but here you see a structure. Probably if you have seen with wave surfer, for instance, spectrogram, then you can start realizing, you can see with a high resolution spectrogram, you can see such a picture. Please.
Every time one of these new peaks is born, doesn't that change K in the frame that you
Correct.
Have to synthesize, and now you've got to go back and pick new gammas because you have more of them?
The K can be constant, like, for instance, can be, as I said, for 4,000 or 5,000 bandwidth, as it is here. Let's say, through trials and errors, we found that about approximately 80 components are good. So that means we pick up standard numbers. This is also very convenient when you do speech coding, because you have a constant vector to play with.
So now they're born among the ones that you've already
picked. Yeah. Okay. Now, once we have made the association from this frame to the other frame and future frames, now we know which component is associated with which component, then we have to generate samples not only at the center of our analysis window, because speech is not only there, speech has samples between the analysis frames, the center of the analysis frames. So we have to generate samples between the analysis instances or the synthesis instances. And to do that, we have to interpolate, because the Sinusoidal model has two mainly components, because the frequency is already there in the modeling, amplitude and phase. So you know the amplitude here, you know the amplitude here, but what is the amplitude between? You know the phase here, you know the phase here, but what is the phase as a time-varying function between the analysis time instance? And this is why the paper got the best paper award, is because of the previous analysis, but mainly because of this one. For amplitudes, the easiest thing to do is say it is linear. Does not change in a very simple way. This is a linear model. And for phase, however, we use a cubic phase interpolation model. That, I must say that, of course, Quartieri and Macaulay, they publish it, but was Almeida, also in Portugal, who was talking about cubic phase model at the same time. And these people were going towards that direction independently. Just Macaulay and Quartieri were lucky. The paper has been accepted, so everybody recognized that this is their work, and they got the best paper award. Why, however, they work towards the same direction? This is the phase. If we have such a phase model, what is the frequency model? You think? What is the connection between phase and frequency? In order to get the phase, you have to integrate the function that describes the frequency. So that means if the frequency is a model of order 10, the integration will increase the order and the phase will be a polynomial of order 11. Now that I said that, the polynomial order of phase is 3. So what is then the order of the frequency? 2. Which means it moves, it's not constant. Between the two estimations, the frequency is allowed to move, not to stay constant, with a quadratic polynomial. So it has really some components. The problem is that how to estimate the unknowns. Here, there are no unknowns. We have the amplitudes. But here, you have unknowns. Zeta or zeta, as we say in Greek, gamma, alpha, beta. And why I don't have it here? Okay, I don't have it here. But if you go to the paper, there are sufficient conditions, initial and final conditions, that if you write them down and you know that, for instance, the derivative of the phase at this time instant is equal to the frequency that you have estimated, and the same thing to that, and then the phase at the this time instant that you made the analysis is mainly is that zeta. Then same thing from the phase at the next time, and also that you have to take into account that the phase is estimated always modulo 2 pi. Do you know what does that mean? Or do you know why it is estimated modulo 2 pi? This is because it is estimated through an arctangent function, arctan, let's say, and that is modulo 2 pi are the values between minus pi and pi. But this does not mean that we have only these values. These are the principal values, as we say, of the function. Then also, if you add another 2 pi equal, you have the values of the same function, etc., etc. So modulo 2 pi means that all your values is between minus pi and pi. And these are the principal values of that function. If you take this into account, then you will estimate this. And that is a paper that you can read. It's not necessary to go into the details. Now, if we do the system, the analysis and synthesis, then you see that we take now the phase, this is the generator, phases and frequencies, with we have done this matching. We do phase to phase, to frame to frame phase unwrapping and interpolation. This unwrapping is mainly the estimation of Z, gamma, alpha, beta parameters. Amplitudes, you do linear interpolation. So now you have the phase and the amplitude at each sample, not just at the center of the analysis window. And then this is a sine wave generator, that means cosine of this theta, multiply by the amplitude, we sum, and we get the signal. This is the SynSIG model. And this is the synthesis, the block diagram of synthesis. Does it work? Well, it works. Here, upper, is the original speech. And actually, this is from a jazz singer. It's a very difficult voice to model. And this is what the SynSIG model produces. Optically, it's the same. Now, there are some details, however, which are missing. We have to plot the error between these two. We will see that later, and definitely you will have the opportunity during the hands-on version session to see a lot of these things. Okay, so that was all about this. But now I hope you learned a lot. And you know now what is gamma k, how to estimate it, what is fk, how to estimate it, etc. We can make, again, as I said, we can constrain the frequencies to be k times f0. So then we don't need to estimate fks with peak picking. Just we estimate one. We find the periodic signal, what is the period. Then 1 over the period, we have the F0, and then all the frequencies, we make the constraint that there are integer multiples of that fundamental frequency. Then we arrive to the harmonic model. And then, since we know the frequencies, it's very simple. We can do the same thing, but it's not necessary to go here, really, to do that. Just projection of the observations to that space is enough. So that goes towards the harmonic plus noise model. Now, we said about harmonic, but why a noise model comes from? From where that comes from? It is because really the speech cannot have only harmonics or cannot have only sinusoids. Of course, we said that sinusoids can be good also to represent noise. But if we have a mechanism to estimate noise in a different way, probably we have also different tools that we can apply when we want to modify the speech, not only to reconstruct the speech, but to modify it, because then we will have a decomposition of speech, decomposing the harmonic part from the noise part. Then you have strategies, different strategies, to modify each part and then put them together and reconstruct the modified speech. That was the necessity why we started to think about the hybrid systems, or let's say more complex kind of harmonic plus noise model. So this is the harmonic part. Again, here I start using now omega zero. The noise part, the speech is the harmonic part, like the sinusoidal part, as we... this is like the sinusoids, but just they are harmonics. And the noise part, it is modeled as a modulated by this... It's modulated by ET noise component, which is... This is a filter, and this is white noise. Convolving white noise by a filter, this you get a colored noise. It's not anymore white. And then you modulate that with E of T, and this is very important, so that when you put together the harmonic part and the noise part, this will not sound as a noisy speech, noisy harmonics, but a harmonics extended by the noise part. Not This is very important, how to fuse these two components. Otherwise, again, you will get just a noisy H of T. So now we will see three models of H of T and a model for N of T. So the first model is simply essential exponential functions. We say without slope because the next one has slopes. This is, we go back to the notation of F0, but nevertheless, this is K times omega 0. And these are a simple harmonic model. Nothing to say more about that. And these are notations to say for the analysis, A stands for analysis, and I stands for the ith frame. The HNM2 is similar to this, but that function of AK is AK of N is this one. Now, you can recognize that the first part is exactly the same, but has another term, like a slope, because this is order of 1 as a function of n, another term, bk. Now, this can be simply be a slope, but because ak and bk are complex numbers, not real numbers, this is a bit more complicated than that. And we will see, because all the work on the adaptive advanced sinusoidal model comes from this equation. And we will see after lunch. Then there is another third model, which it is an AM-FM decomposition, where the AM is a polynomial, like the previous one, of time. This is order 1. This is order and the phase is just a linear, and this is the displacement, and this is a constant frequency. So this is a simple information for phase. The amplitude is a p-order polynomial, but what is the difference between this and the previous polynomial, this one? Of course, this is order 1, this is order p. That's the one difference. But it's not really that difference. The difference is not that. It is that these parameters, c, k, 0, 1, p, here, they are real numbers now. They are not complex numbers. That really is a big difference between HNM3 and HNM2. Okay. So we have now modeled the harmonic part. This is the speech. If from speech I extract, I remove the harmonic part, then I will going to have the residual part, which hopefully is just the noise component. Then I have to model this. Okay. How do I estimate? I do a minimization of the mean squared error, again, between the harmonic model and the speech, the observations, and this is the window that I use for analysis. Then for HNM 1 and 2, this has the solution has a quadratic form and can be solved easily using linear equations. However, HNM 3 is a nonlinear system and has to be solved in a different way. So once this is estimated, hat means estimation, we subtract this from the speech and we get the estimation of the residual signal. And here is an example of this subtraction, that the noise component. So if this is a speech, this is from a sound like zzz, that sound. It's from a very famous word that I used all over my during my PhD, vazi vaza, and that is the z sound comes from, and it's very important because it must be modulated. If you don't do it well, it will be sound like vashi, vashi, vasha, or noisy. It will not sound like z vazi vaza. So we wanted to talk about the localization of that noise part. So nevertheless, we we estimate now these components, we subtract the harmonic part, so only hopefully the noise part remains. So this is the error then, the R of N, using the first model, the simple harmonic model. You see there is a lot of components here, low frequencies. This is the error from H&M2 with this complex slope, let's call it, order 1. And this is with order 3, the H&M3. So these two produce kind of similar error. But the difference between these two is that this uses a polynomial with real coefficients, while here it's a polynomial of order 1 with complex coefficients. Here we show what is the variance of the residual signal for H&M1. So you can see that at the center, this is the center of our analysis window, the variance of the error is very small. This is why, because that means the estimation, because you put a window, the estimation is very accurate for H&M1 at the center of the analysis window. But more you go towards the edges of your analysis, the variance is very big, and this you don't like that. That means it's not a good estimation. Now, if you go to H&M2 and H&M3, obviously you get also a good estimation at the center, but you have also low variance, so that means good estimation, also towards the edges. So that means H&M2 and H&M3 are more robust, more powerful models. But obviously, you can say easily that, yes, but H&M2 and H&M3 uses more parameters than H&M1. So it is obvious to have such a performance. Okay, we will talk about that later. Here is the original speech, and here is the error in the power of error in dB for this vazi vaza. That's the vazi vaza. So you see where is, and we do the harmonic modeling only up, this is 16 kilohertz sampling frequency, so the bandwidth is 8 kilohertz. We model only the first 4 kilohertz with harmonics, and all the rest from 4 to 8 with noise. So here we see the modeling error from the whole bandwidth. The error that we do around Z is big. This is an vaziza error. For H&M1, even for this error, this is error in dB, like around 20 is the minimum, the average error, minus 20 dB. While when we go with the H&M1 and the H&M2 in these areas where we don't have this Z, so because we don't model it, we don't model H is not for the unvoiced or the fricative voiced sound of Z. So that's why they have all the models have errors here. So when we model this part with H, so the error goes to minus 40 dB. Or minus 35 dB on average. To understand the meaning of these numbers, if this is below 25, you cannot hear any difference between the reconstructed signal and the original. Okay? So, now that was, these were the models for the sinusoidal model. Now we, there's a question? Yeah.
So what is the advantage of using the HNM3 or HNM2, given that the error signals are not that very different from HNM3?
So could you repeat the question?
What is the advantage of using the HNM3 over HNM2? It's not that much of a difference in the error signals.
Yeah, if we use HNM2 and HNM3, compared to H&M1, we have a lot of gain in these areas. Now, in these areas, because we model up to 4 kilohertz, and all the energy of the fricative voice is above that, not all, there is some, because here we are in minus 10 dB. That means these models, they cannot touch, we are not allowed them to process, to model information which is above 4 kilohertz. That's why we see this error for all the models. If I allow the models to go beyond 4 kilohertz, and we will see later on results on that, that is the adaptive sinusoidal model, you will see that the HNM2 is and HNM3 are much more effective even for these areas. But then I allow them to model this information. Here, I put a barrier. Don't go beyond 4 kilohertz. Okay? So, really, the most important point is that whenever I have the most of the energy up to 4 kilohertz, let's put it that way, then I have a very good modeling. So, yes, please.
And is there any case when you would prefer a term 2 to 3?
That is next lecture.
Because I think that
you are, okay, sorry. We will talk about that. We will focus on HNM2, but after that I will comment on HNM3. So now the noise, it is if this is F, the noise, let's say, is something like that. So you model this with autoregressive models so that the models, the model is like that. So you, by using this A autoregressive model, the red line, you can model the frequency content. And then you can, this which is noise, white noise, if you pass this noise, which is white noise, through this red filter, the output will be like the blue one. And then you transform a white noise to a colored noise. And that is the frequency information of the of the noise. But we go now to the time domain characteristics. That is very important in order to fuse the harmonic and the noise model. So here it is a zoom of z sound, voice fricative. And this is when I subtract, let's say, HNM2 model from this one, this is the error that I get. So you see that the error is quite noisy, but it is localized in time. And this localization is very important to fuse. Let's say if you are able to reproduce this, to put it back on the harmonic speech, so that at the end you have something like that, like the upper panel. So how to do this localization? It is the next topic. Because if you pass the white noise through that filter to have the colored noise, that is okay. So you have similar frequency content as this process, as this, but not the localized properties of that process. And that is the modulation. Simple ways to do this. Another way, that is time domain envelope, we can do Hilbert transform, low pass, and model it as that. A third one is to do it, to model it, this one, because you have many parameters, to model it with few sinusoids, like let's say 3-4 sinusoids. And then this is what we can get with N equals to 7. What is N? So just delay. If we do this moving average, this is moving average filter with N equals 7, Then we do, using few Fourier series decomposition, the Fourier series decomposition here, we use just 3 to 4 parameters, and then we can model that. And here is now a comparison. I think I'm done. I'm done. I just a second, please. Yeah. I have 2 slides, and then we are over. So here is the signal, the upper panel, is that the R of n that we have seen. This is when you put this triangular envelope as a simple deterministic envelope. So you can see you don't have really this localization anymore. And when you put this back to H and you add them together to have the reconstructed signal probably will sound noisy, H of n, not really the two components fused together. This is when we use Hilbert envelope, and this is when we use this energy envelope after averaging and use 3 to 4 Fourier series components. So you can see that this solution is not deterministic. It's deterministic in that sense, but it is estimated through data while this is imposed. And this one has better localization properties compared to these 3, 2 to this one. And here I had some samples. It's not necessary for you now to play this, but you will have hands-on version, and you can have hands-on session, and you can have headphones, so you can really compare. Otherwise, it's not going to work. Now, this is my last slide, saying that F0, of course, is a simplification of the frequency content of speech, and you can see that by put together the Fourier transform of speech, this is the continuous line, and the harmonic model, that means k times f0. This is the dashed, this is magnitude spectrum, and this is the dashed line. This is the harmonic model. Probably we have a very good accuracy of modeling up to, let's say, 3,000 hertz. But above that, you see there is drifting. That's normal, because F0 is not a good representation of the speech spectrum. Now, there are ways to estimate better F0s. And indeed, then, you do very good job, even up to 4 kilohertz. And 5 kilohertz, depends on the voice. But the reality is that these are just some pictures. And the frequency content changes can change fast, and F0, it's under, we don't know really if it is, if such information exists on speech. So there are problems in estimating the frequencies. Either if you say K times F0, it's not accurate. Even if you have a good F0 estimator, this does not work all the time. It is a good model, but not very accurate. And if you do peak picking, or you estimate frequencies and you do, let's say, we call it spectral estimation. This is mainly spectral estimation methods, a topic of statistical signal processing. You will not go far away. I mean, because there are errors in these frequencies. Now, how to deal with these frequency errors, because if the frequencies are good, everything is good. Then amplitudes, phases, everything is well estimated. How to address this problem of not well estimation of frequencies is exactly why we started to do the advanced sinusoidal models, which is the topic of the next lecture. Okay? So we will start with that problem. So, concluding, I try to give you the basis of the sinusoidal model and, more important, to make the connection between the speech production and the sinusoidal model. I introduce you also to notation that I'm going to use the next lecture. So the next lecture will be much faster. And it's going to be about the advanced sinusoidal model and how to estimate its parameters, and how this can be used in many applications. One is speech synthesis. Okay, so thank you very much for your attention. And then we will see, hopefully, later on the advantages to use HNM2 or et cetera. Okay? Thank you.